because on the whole, Japanese are shorter than Caucasians from North America. If we went to some parts in Africa and sampled, let's say the Watusi, we would see it shifting that direction. So, yeah.
The reason that female girls are a little bit taller is because there are more females in the world now.
No, it's just that they, it's called kurtosis, and different populations gather around different spots. In this case, female population seems to be a little bit narrower and a little bit taller. See, the more you narrow this, the more it has to go tall. It just means that women are, there's more women.
The girls the same.
Yeah, there's more women in the average area than there are men. And that's true of a lot of characteristics. There are differences by gender. And this is not just true of height. So, you can see here that there's significant overlap on this thing we're measuring height. So, height is partially inherited. In fact, 60 to 80% of your height is inherited based upon your genetics, what genes you got born with. Now, the other 20 to 40%, and it varies somewhat, is based on other things, like how good a nutrition you had, whether you were physically active, or what diseases you might have had as a child. I mean, there's a lot of other things that could happen that might make you shorter or taller. You know, maybe you had a pituitary gland malfunction like that one guy did, and you grew up excessively fast, excessively tall. That would not necessarily be genetic. In fact, it could even be non-genetic. Chemicals can get into the baby, or chemicals get into us as children and disrupt the hormonal structure and the growth factor structure, and before you know it, you got a growth problem. You got children that aren't growing at all, or children growing too fast, and you see both those problems sometimes. So nutrition, external environment. If you have very short parents, chances are you are going to be taller than your parents. Chances are. You're not going to be shorter than, you're going to be somewhat taller. You're going to be short, but you're not just going to be short, you're going to be a little bit taller than them. If you are born to very tall parents, chances are you're going to be tall, but you're going to be a little bit shorter than your parents. And that's called, in statistics, it's called regression to the mean. The populations tend to move towards the center, statistically, over a period of time. Come on in. We have a place, yeah, here, all right, over here. Oh, you got a chair there? All right. In twin studies, if you take two identical twins, you can predict one-tenth twin's height by knowing the other twin's height. If Cole had a twin and we didn't know who that twin was or anything about him, I could measure Cole's height and I could predict 81% of the height of his twin, even though I'd never seen the twin. Because that shows us that a height is really highly genetically programmed. Well, personality, I mean, so we can see that twins have similar height based on genetics, and if they're not twins, let's say we've got non-identical twins, you can only predict about 20%, 20 to 30% from one twin to the other. They're non-identical. So they're identical, 81%. So it shows us that 81% of height is probably genetic. What about personality characteristics? How many of you would say you're extroverted? Okay, how many of you would say you're introverted? All right. You were born with that characteristic. There is actually genetics that determine that. That doesn't mean you can't learn to be more extroverted if you were more introverted, or vice versa, but probably if you have the genetics for an introverted person, you're going to be introverted your whole life. That's not going to change. And you're going to actually have to work harder to be more outgoing. Whereas the extroverts have to work harder to keep their big mouth shut. Right? Am I correct, Holly? Just taking a wild guess here, okay? Now, 50% of your personality, the personality you're setting right here in this room right now, 50% of that personality came to you through your genes. And I get a lot of argument with people about that. Say, wait, that's not possible. Well, let's take a little example here. How many of you had a dog? Okay. You look at these dogs. If you know anything about dogs, and I'm not going to do this right now, I could point to the dog and you could tell me that dog's personality, could you not? Black lab. What's the characteristics of a black lab? Okay.
Always has that look on its face.
Right. How many of you know my dog, Sugar? What's her characteristics?
Sweet.
He's the sweetest dog in the world. She told me I could not do this presentation if I didn't put her picture up here. So I'm being just doing what Sugar tells me to. German Shepherd.
Authoritarian.
Yeah. So
attentive.
If personality is inherited in dogs, it's the same DNA. Folks, we get DNA inheritance from our parents. Dogs get it from their parents. You are who you are 50% because of the genes you've got in your system. Now, our culture and our religions would tell us that's not right. We have been told since we were born that people develop their personalities from their environment and from their education, from their training and all that. Well, 50% of that is bullshit. Because half of it did not come from the environment, did not come from your teachers or your parents. And I'll talk a bit about that later. There are other distributed characteristics. You know, you remember the bell curve? Well, we could do bell curves on intelligence, IQ. You can ask what people's IQ is or test them. I used to give IQ tests a lot when I was practicing clinical psychologist. And man, they just fall right into the bell curve. It's a fairly, in statistics they call it a fairly normal distribution, IQ is. Extroversion, introversion, dominance, non-dominant. How many of you just say you're a fairly dominant personality? No, Iggy, you're not. How many would say you're a non-dominant personality? Okay. Now you notice some people aren't raising their hands on either one because they're neither. And they can kind of go back and forth. Same for extroversion, introversion. How many of you don't think you're either one, extrovert or introvert? You are perverts. I'm a pervert too, by the way. That's why I'm standing up here talking about sex. Now, there's actually a technical term for those who don't score at either one of these. It's called ambivert. But you get more laughs with a pervert joke. Anyway. And then detail and big picture focus. How many of you are a big picture kind of person? You hate details. Okay, how many of you think are details? Don't read my book because you might find a mistake, okay? No, I'm kidding. Yeah, that's the problem with those detail people. After that darn thing's been proofread 3 times, we still found 2 mistakes so far. And then sexuality itself falls on a bell curve. And we'll find out more about that. As does religiosity. Now this is a newsflash for some people. Religiosity is an inherited trait. Period. And I'll come back and explain why I argue that. To begin with, let's understand a concept. It was first introduced by a Harvard assistant professor, Judith Ridge Harris. She published some revolutionary findings in 1997. She did a meta-analysis of hundreds of surveys on personality development. And what she found is now called the 50-0-50 principle. I'm going to explain it in a minute. But when she published this, she was also up for tenure at Harvard for associate professor, full professor, I'm not sure which. They so disagreed with her research that she did not make tenure. And she had to go find another job. Well, I think she went to Berkeley or somewhere like that, and she's laughing all the way to the bank. Because in what she published in 1997, it took about 5 years for people to start realizing, dang, she's right. It's a whole new paradigm shift, a whole new way of understanding human personalities. But people had missed this until she came along and did it. So she published this idea that 50% of your personality is genetic. Now, how do we know this? Because we can take twins who were raised totally separate, people who don't even know they have a twin. For example, one is raised in California and the other is raised in Montreal, Canada. Give them personality tests and their personalities will look 50% the same. You could predict the personality of twin B from just testing the personality of twin A. Now, if I took a personality test, I could not predict your personality based on my personality test. And if I knew your sister or brother, if I tested your sister or brother, I could only predict about 20% of their personality based upon testing them and to predict you. So that shows us, and there's lots more research, the twin studies that have been done over the last 20 years just put the nail on the coffin. There is absolutely no doubt that about 50%, actually it varies between 49 and 50%, what's 1%? 50% of your personality comes from your parents. And the twin studies which shows us this. And we also know, we can see that just what breed of a dog it is. That shows us personalities inherited through dogs. We know the same thing about chimps. We know the same thing about humans. Then the 50% of personality, there's another 50% out there, isn't there? Where's that going to go to? Well, you will be surprised about this. There's two more parts to the 50-0-50. The first is genetic. The second is what we're going to call shared environment. And the third we're going to call non-shared environment. And I'll define those real quick. Shared environment is the environment that you and your siblings all shared under one roof. Let's say you got two brothers or sisters, and you're all raised together under one roof. That is your shared environment. The non-shared environment, though, is where you differ from those. You were born in a different, unless you're identical twins, you were older or younger than somebody else in the family. You had your own bedroom, or you weren't sleeping in identical spots in that bedroom. I mean, my house, we had bunk beds, and I had to sleep, you know, in a bunk bed above my brother. So that's a different spot in the house. I had my own desk. My brother didn't need a desk. He was always out, you know, interacting and playing football and stuff, and I was in the house reading books or doing science experiments, and my mom was always trying to say, "Brad, why don't you get in there and help Darrel do a science experiment?" And, oh man, Brad hated it because she would make him help me dissect dead possums, roadkill possums, and you know, stuff like that. The only time Brad wanted to help me with a science experiment is when we were blowing something up. Yeah. Then he was right there to help me. So we literally lived in the same house, lived in the same bedroom, and our if you knew my brother Brad, you knew me, very different personalities here. Very different. So he was 2 years younger than me, so he was in a different place in school. He had different interests. You know, he was more interested in sports than I was. He was less interested in music than I was. You know, all those kinds of things. There's quite a few differences going on here. And my mother decided early on that every one of us had to take 2 years of piano, whether we liked it or not. And she forced us to take 2 years of piano. Four boys in the family, no girls. Four boys. And my mother, poor mother, she suffered through all this. She probably suffered more than we did. Minute my 2 years was up, I'm out of there. You know? But it was kind of a trick. I think she knew that if she forbid us to do something, then we'd really want to do it. So as soon as I got rid of that piano, I went and got a violin and started playing that. So, and my brother got a trumpet, and my other brother got, I don't remember what he got, a guitar or something. But anyway, we all went on to do a little bit of music for about a year or two. But even though she was forcing music down us, I am the only one in the family that did anything with music after sixth grade. In other words, once we started getting out from underneath our mother's thumb. And I did not do the kind of music my mom thought would have liked me to do either. So even there, she didn't have a lot of influence. So 50-0-50, what we're now seeing and what Judith Rich Harris found was parents have almost no impact on personality development of the child. Now, you might be surprised by that. Julie was very surprised when we first started reading about this, or when she first started reading about it. So let me show you how that works. This is the shared environment, the environment that parents create for the child. And twin studies show that personality develops largely independent of the parents' own preferences. So the parents, I'll explain this a little bit later, parents want you to do one thing, but if your genetic predisposition is to go this way, you're probably going to go this way. Think about it. Could you train a black lab to act like a toy Manchester? Probably not. It's not going to happen. Could you take a German Shepherd and get him to act like a Yorkie? Yeah. Yeah, that'd be scary, wouldn't it? I mean, could you take and force an animal like a dog to behave like and with the personality characteristics of a totally different breed. No, it is impossible. You can't.